So, you know what I want to do today? Since I got a little bit of time, we're going to see which euphonium is best euphonium. But not from any kind of pure perspective or anything, because I'm not really that good. I'm a hobbyist, and my musicianship is long gone. But I still have one skill that slightly still remains. That is making this thing lie in my favor. Now don't worry, I'm not going to cheat and make any of these instruments look worse than they are. Because what good would that do me? No. I want to see which of my three euphoniums, euphonium and two halves, there can actually put up a decent showing on here. That's fair, isn't it? So, obviously the first one up is going to be the Besson. Because with its three-valve Berkeley automatic compensating system, this instrument should be able to easily dominate any competition of intonation. I will be using my Josef Klier Euphonium 12B. This is 24 millimeter wide, extremely deep for such a small diameter. Nice big fat throat. I think you can figure out why I didn't go with anything deeper. Let's do this. Oh, and of course, before you accuse me of my reverse engineered shank being wrong and affecting the intonation, I have checked that. And also, before you accuse me of being, prejudiced, actually, I'm going to take it easy on this horn, because I know it's been beat up and damaged. It's been apart and repaired. I know exactly what I'm going to see on here. I've done this before. I'm not going to beat this thing up too bad. I know it's not going to play that well. Check intonation on pedal tones. So far so good. A little bit flat at the bottom, no problem. Octave expansion is to be expected, no sweat. Not bad. That usually shows up about 20 cents flat, so good on me for making that look good. That's actually pretty good, isn't it? How about that? Hard to get up to that E. This is a really deep mouthpiece, okay? But let me tell you something. You guys that complain about having to play A above the staff or whatever the hell that is, concert G, get good, man. Either get good or quit playing a bucket. I mean, I'm a nobody. I'm not playing in a group regularly. I don't get, like, regular practice. I'm just a guy. And I can play that concert B-flat on this big whopping thing. Practice, get good, or change your mouthpiece. Sufficiently say the Besson is doing a good job. It's good on it. I've tried when it was a little warmer, and this thing, when it's actually really warmed up, it shows its repairs. But I'm not gonna hold that against it. And next up, the Conn 20i with its stupid, obnoxious 11 and a quarter millimeter shank. Oh, what a dumbass I am. I have custom mouthpieces that all go to only one horn. Ah, whatever. This is the Josef Clear EU-12C. That might not look all that deep to you, but rest assured, it's quite deep. It's deeper than a 44E4, which makes it deeper than a 6.5 AL. So, yeah, this is a manly mouthpiece. It might not look like it, but it is. Now, let's see how much those Blakely automatic compensating valves were doing for the Besson. OG, interesting. It's almost as if you can just pull your tuning slides and get the same effect. Slides out too far. Let's fix that. What was that? What was that there? There we go. Yeah, that's better. Colder than I think it is. Hold on. less than 10 cents flat. Whatever. It's about 20 years older, and also beat up and played after death, but I suppose the Conn is worse than the Besson. Who'd have thought? Granted, that's not really that bad, but it counts for something. Well, let's see how this does. This thing is way too big for me to take time to actually warm it up, so I'm just going to push the slide in and hope for the best! See how the Meister does with the Josef Clear TH-12D. It is quite a, it's a decently deep mouthpiece. Not nearly as deep as the Euphonium mouthpieces, but it's alright. It's backed by a 12mm shank, which I customized the horn to fit. And it has a backbore and throat that are appropriate for an oval form instrument. So, all in all, this is a very custom mouthpiece for an oval form horn. It's going to perform its job. Interesting. I wonder how much of that is the horn being too cold. That's pretty bad. Cents flat, a little over. That's okay. Fifth partial, whatever. There you go. Got that D on lockdown if I need it. That's very interesting. Why is F sharp on 2 flat and open G is in tune? Got some interesting intonation going on there. That's kind of what oval form instruments are known for, isn't it? People call the intonation interesting because that doesn't make any sense whatsoever. But, you know, there is just a certain charm. Certain charm to an oval form. Especially the ergonomics. Let me look at this. I got a strap on this thing. I can just easily bring it down. It sits here. It's like the horn gives me a hug instead of me having to give it a hug. I don't have to even touch the thing. It's just here comfortably. You don't get that from piston upright. Not even with the strap. There's no way to strap one that it fits like this on you. So, it's adequate. It's not great. So, is the Besson the best euphonium? Well, you know what? According to this guy, yes it is! What'd I tell you? If you don't care what it sounds like, and you know, I'm not a huge fan of the Besson sound most of the time, although I kind of like it with my mouthpiece. A small diameter kind of gives me a little bit of something that I feel like I'm missing with a big old bucket. So, if you don't mind that part though, and you just want something that plays really good in tune, and it's going to be able to move up and down the scale evenly without having to, you know, push a little extra hard in the bottom or at the top. Yeah. These old-timey Bessons. What'd I tell you? They're the way to go. You know if you want one. And if you want one, better get one.